In my previous class, I explained about the different terms related to mastoid exploration and also the canal wall up and canal wall down procedures. After knowing that, it will be easier for you to understand what is a canal wall up and a canal wall down procedure. Today I will talk about cortical mastoidectomy. Indications, contraindication, the steps of cortical mastoidectomy, postoperative care and the complications. So there are synonyms for cortical mastoidectomy. One is a simple mastoidectomy. It's very comparatively simple. It's not very simple. It is comparatively simple procedure. So we call it a simple mastoidectomy or a complete mastoidectomy. Or a Schwartz procedure. Schwartz mastoidectomy or a cortical mastoidectomy. So these are the synonyms of a cortical mastoidectomy. So what are the indications? In previous classes, we discussed about mast mastoiditis, then acute coalescent mastoiditis, also acute separative otitis media with reservoir site. All these are explained in previous classes. Mastoiditis is collection of pus within the mastoid air cells, and it becomes a walled off cavity. It is not going through the middle ear and it is not getting drained out. So if that condition is called an acute coalescent mastoiditis. So one indication is an acute coalescent mastoiditis with or without next stage, that is the subperiosteal abscess. Treatment, medical treatment, but not in the current dosage. Again, that will go to a mast mastoiditis or a latent mastoiditis. That is also an indication. Okay, mast mastoiditis. Then, you know, acute separative otitis media, and if there is a pinhole sized perforation of the tympanic membrane and the middle ear is filled with the So the middle ear is filled with the discharge, and also the mastoid filled with discharge. Here also it is filled with the secretions or filled with pus, and it is coming out through this small perforation with a lighthouse sign or a reservoir sign, and it is not getting treatment better with the medicines. You gave a course of medicine, it's not getting relieved. You again change the antibiotic according to culture and sensitivity, and again there is no response. Then that is an indication to open this and to drain the pus. Actually, it is an incision and drainage of the abscess. Okay, like that. So that is an ASOM with the reservoir sign. Not all ASOM with reservoir sign, we won't go for a mastoid exploration. And ASOM with reservoir sign, not better with medicines. Okay, so these are the mastoid indications of a cortical mastoidectomy. And also this cortical mastoidectomy can be done as an approach to various areas. One is to the inner ear, approach to inner ear, that is to mainly to the labyrinth for a labyrinthectomy. And second, as an approach to which is a nerve in relation to this, that is a facial nerve. So in a for facial nerve decompression, we can go through this. And third, as an approach to endolymphatic sac surgery. Endolymphatic sac. Okay. Then also we can go to the petrous apex. And to the skull base. See, this is a skull base area. So we can go to the skull base. Also we can go to the CP angle. Okay. And one more commonly used indication is a cochlear implant surgery. Okay. So, as an approach to cochlear implantation, inner ear surgeries, then especially labyrinthectomy, then facial nerve decompression, endolymphatic sac surgery, to the petrous apex, to the skull base and to the CP angle, especially for acoustic neuroma surgeries. So these are the indications of a cortical mastoidectomy. What are the contraindications of cortical mastoidectomy? Cholesteatoma in which the patient is not willing to come for follow-up. Second, the posterior canal wall. This posterior canal wall is very much damaged. A reconstruction is not possible. Then don't go for a canal wall up procedure. Third, a labyrinthine fistula. Fourth, a cholesteatoma which is very tightly, or the matrix is adherent to which all structures? The facial nerve or to the labyrinth or any of these structures, endolymphatic sac or petrous apex or any of these structures. Then we have to go for a canal wall down procedure. Don't go with a cortical mastoidectomy. Okay, so we at least remember, a cholesteatoma in which the posterior canal wall is not preservable because of the nature of the disease process, or if the patient is not willing to come back for follow-up. In that cases, never go for a cortical mastoidectomy. So you have to remember that this otorrhea and ear infection is not a contraindication for a mastoid exploration. Preoperatively, you have to admit the patient and control ear infection and otorrhea, then go for a cortical mastoidectomy. Okay, for all mastoidectomies, these two are not a contraindication. William Wiles posterior incision, it was already described. Incision deepened up to the periosteum. Periosteum incised. Then elevating the periosteal flap with the mastoid periosteal elevator, and after that we have to use Morrison's self-retaining hemostatic mastoid retractor. It is a self-retaining retractor. No assistance is needed to hold this instrument, and secure hemostasis by lateral pressure over the tissues, and also it retracts the tissues away from the field of surgery. So that is Morrison's self-retaining hemostatic mastoid retractor. After this, we have to identify the McEwen's triangle. Now the pointer is on the spina fenli. As I already told, spina fenli is a bony projection from the posterior superior canal wall, that is a posterior canal wall, and you can also see the skin flap, that is a skin of the external artery canal elevated from the posterior canal wall. So McEwen's triangle is identified superiorly by the superior temporal line, and anteriorly posterior canal wall, and posteriorly a tangent drawn to the posterior superior canal wall. And there the bone is cribriform. You can see the porosities there, and the mastoid antrum usually lies 1 to 1.5 cm or 1.5 to 2 cm deep to the McEwen's triangle. And after identification of the McEwen's triangle, the removal of the mastoid cortex and exposure of the antrum using drill. Commonly we use a micromotor drill, and also cutting burr of larger size is used for drilling the cortex.
Larger burrs are preferred over the smaller one whenever possible. And a burr with a cutting surface is selected for cortical bone. And the diamond grain surface is for removing the last layer of bone over the facial nerve, sigmoid sinus, tegmen, and opening the facial recess. Also, ensure adequate suction irrigation. That is to prevent excessive heat transfer to the underlying structures and also to keep the bone cool. And while drilling, you can see you will reach the corner septum. It is not always seen. This corner septum may not be there in all cases, but if present, you should be careful, as this corner septum can be misdiagnosed as the medial wall of mastoid andrum, but the actual andrum will lie medial or deep to the corner septum, and there is chance that we will miss the real pathology underneath. So that is corner septum. In this case, you can see it beautifully. And if corner septum or petrosquamous lamina is there, you have to drill it out also. And once this corner septum has been opened, you can see the lateral semicircular canal along the medial surface of the adductus and andrum. And the lateral semicircular canal is a critical landmark in mastoid surgery, as the second genuofacial nerve is almost always inferior to the midpoint of this lateral semicircular canal. And you can see the almost completed cortical mastoidectomy. That is the posterior canal wall anteriorly. Superiorly, there should be the dural plate. Posteriorly, the sinus plate and digastric groove inferiorly, and also a widened and patent adductus with a lateral semicircular canal.
What about the postoperative care? Immediately after completion of the mastoid exploration, we are giving a mastoid bandage to the patient, to that operated ear. And if it is combined with a tympanoplasty, then some surgeons will pack the ear canal also. So if there is a mastoid bandage, it has to be removed minimum 24 to 48 hours after the surgery, and ask the patient to keep the ear dry and keep the operated ear free of infection. And the antibiotics which are started before surgery should be continued for minimum of 10 days, 10 post-operative days. And usually we remove the stitches after 5 to 7 days. And if it is combined with a meningoplasty or a tympanoplasty, the instructions as to keep the ear dry, avoid entry of water into the ear, and avoid forceful blowing of the nose, and also avoid weightlifting and also flying and swimming for minimum of 1 to 2 months. After surgery, what will be the appearance of the mastoid cavity? So this will be the external artery canal, and this will be the tympanic membrane, right? For the right side, the tympanic membrane and posterior canal wall, and the patient lying down for right ear. So here comes the dural plate. Okay, and here will be the sinus plate. And down will be the digastric notch, tip cell digastric notch will be there, and the adductus. Okay, here comes the adductus. So adductus, because this is the if this is the external artery canal and if this is the tympanic membrane, this area of it will be that of attic, isn't it? So this is attic and adytus. Through adytus, the middle ear communicates with the mastoid area. So in relation to that, you will see the what is this? That is a short rose of incus in the fossa incudis. Okay, so immediately near to that will be the lateral semicircular canal or the horizontal semicircular canal. Usually this is seen as a yellowish white bulge. The color will be different from that of the neighboring structures. And anteromedial to that lies the facial nerve. From here, from the second genu, the facial nerve comes and starts its vertical root. So these are the structures in relation to, this will be the posterior semicircular canal will lie here. The Donaldson line is a line passing through the lateral semicircular canal and bisecting the posterior semicircular canal. So this is the Donaldson line, and your endolymphatic sac lies inferior to the Donaldson line. So then this will be the, somewhere here will be the area of endolymphatic sac, and this is Donaldson line. Here comes the sinodural angle or the Sittelli angle. What is the importance of this Sittelli angle? It is the commonest site of a residual or a recurrent disease after surgery. So this area has to be thoroughly inspected after completion of any type of mastoid exploration, and also this is the root into a superior vetrosus sinus. Solid angle is the angle formed between three semicircular canal which lies medial to the mastoid angle. Okay, so it is the lateral, posterior and superior will come here. So it is an angle formed between these three, that is solid angle. And another important one is a Trautmann's triangle. Okay, and this Trautmann's triangle actually lies between, anteriorly comes the bony labyrinth, posteriorly the sigmoid sinus, and superiorly there is a superior vetrosus sinus. So it comes almost here. Okay, Trautmann's triangle. So the Trautmann's triangle bounded anteriorly by what is a bony labyrinth. This is a bony labyrinth. Posteriorly, there is a sigmoid sinus, and superiorly, that is a superior vetrosus sinus. The plate of bone in this Trautmann's triangle is highly vascular and cancellous. So if there is infection or a caries of this bone, it can form a perisinus abscess or a sigmoid sinus thrombosis or a posterior fossa brain abscess. So that is the importance of this Trautmann's triangle. And complications again can be divided into at the time of surgery or immediately after surgery or delayed complications. At the time of surgery, I already told, again divided into due to anesthesia and due to surgery. And due to surgery, what are the complications that can happen at the time of procedure? That is definitely the injury to the neighboring structures. Because you are using a high speed drill, there is chance of injury to the posterior canal wall. Without knowing, we will make a hole into the posterior canal wall. That has to be avoided. That is, I already told you, copious suction irrigation will remove the bone dust, and also it will give you a clear idea of the clear look into the neighboring structures. And also you should have a clear knowledge of the anatomy of the structures. So injury to the posterior canal wall, injury to the facial nerve, injury to the ossicle, especially to the incus, and injury to the labyrinth, again injury to the lateral semicircular canal is again common. Then what comes here? Here is the dura, So injury to the dura, and if there is injury to the dura, can be chance of CSF leak. And injury to the sigmoid sinus leading to severe bleed. What are the delayed complications? One is the sensory neural hearing loss, then permanent facial palsy or CSF fistula. And if it is not repaired properly, there is chance of infection going to a brain abscess. And also later on, there is chance of brain fungus also. Brain fungus is again a short note for you.